Hi everybody. In the previous two videos, we solved for the orbitals and the energies of a hydrogen atom. In this video, I'd like to think about how we can use quantum mechanics to at least approximately solve for multi-electron atoms. Compared to multi-electron atoms, the orbital energies and emission spectrum of hydrogen are relatively simple to calculate. The Schrodinger equation, and consequently the Rydberg equation, tell us that the energy of a hydrogen electron depends only on the principal quantum number n. So in the emission spectrum of hydrogen, we see bands that correspond to the light that's emitted when an electron drops from a higher value of n to a lower value of n. As we'll see in this video, things get a bit more complicated for multi-electron atoms. For one, we have to worry about electron-electron repulsion, and we'll talk about that a lot in this video. And a second issue, that we'll talk about a couple of videos in the future, is that we have to think about the different possible spins of the electrons. As we've seen, the Hamiltonian operator for a hydrogenic atom or ion has two terms, and the orbitals and energies can be found exactly. The first term represents the kinetic energy of the relative motion of the electron and nucleus, and the second term represents the electrostatic attraction, the potential energy between the electron and nucleus. But even when there are just two electrons, in a helium atom for example, it becomes impossible to find exact solutions to the Schrodinger equation, and the Hamiltonian operator gets much more complicated. Let's think about the different terms that are in the Hamiltonian operator of a helium atom. Because there are now two electrons and a nucleus, we have to think about the kinetic energy of the first electron, the potential energy of the first electron with the nucleus, the kinetic energy of the second electron, the potential energy of the second electron with the nucleus, and the repulsion between the two electrons. So even adding just one electron to this atom, we've added three different terms to the Hamiltonian. It turns out to be this last term, the electron-electron repulsion term, that really causes problems. With both of the electrons delocalized in orbitals, you can imagine how it would be difficult to think about how the position of one electron affects the energy of the other electron, and vice versa. This electron-electron repulsion term is what makes it impossible to exactly solve the Schrodinger equation for multi-electron systems. Even though we can't solve a multi-electron atom exactly, we'll spend the rest of this video thinking about how we can make reasonable approximations that at least allow us to think about the chemistry of multi-electron atoms. Let's think about a helium atom, which has two electrons. The exact Hamiltonian of helium is shown on this slide. Let's begin by making a very big approximation, that we completely ignore electron-electron repulsion. We just imagine this last term of the Hamiltonian isn't there. Obviously, this is going to make a big change in the energies that we calculate, but at least it's a place to start. If we ignore this electron-electron repulsion term, notice that the Hamiltonian operator now looks like the sum of two separate Hamiltonian operators for helium plus. The first two terms represent the kinetic and potential energy of the first electron with the nucleus, and the last two terms represent the kinetic and potential energy of the second electron with the nucleus. So it's basically just the sum of two helium plus Hamiltonians. And it turns out that that's a problem that we can solve exactly. We have a situation where the Hamiltonian operator can be expressed as the sum of two different Hamiltonian operators that we can solve exactly. And even though it's not exactly clear at first why we're doing this, I want us to suppose that the eigenfunctions of this full Hamiltonian are products of the eigenfunctions of the two separate Hamiltonians. In other words, that the orbitals of a helium atom, as we're approximating it, are the products of the orbitals of two separate helium plus cations. I'd like to briefly go through some math to illustrate why we're doing this. First, we can substitute in H1 plus H2 for the Hamiltonian, and we can substitute in psi1 times psi2 for the wave functions. We can then distribute those two terms, H1 and H2. And then we can recognize that because H1 doesn't operate on psi2 and H2 doesn't operate on psi1, we can actually rearrange those terms to bring psi's out to the front. Next, we can recognize that the Schrodinger equation for our separate helium plus ion tells us that H1 psi1 is just equal to the energy of that first electron times psi1. And H2 times psi2 is the energy of the second electron times psi2. And then, because we're left with just numbers and functions multiplied together, we can change the order of the terms and take out E1 plus E2. Finally, we can remember that psi1, psi2 is the way that we defined our wave functions for the helium atom. So, we're left with this approximate Hamiltonian operator for helium applied to the wave function equals E1 plus E2 times the wave function. E1 and E2 are just the energies of separate helium plus ions. So let's summarize what this tells us. If we can write our Hamiltonian operator as the sum of two different Hamiltonian operators that we can solve, then the orbitals are products of the one-electron orbitals, and the energies are sums of the one-electron energies. So what does this tell us about the ground state energy of a helium atom? It tells us that if we know the energy of a ground state helium plus cation, then we can just multiply that energy by 2 to get the approximate energy of a helium atom. We know from the Rydberg equation that the ground state energy of a hydrogenic species is negative z squared times the Rydberg constant. So for a helium plus cation, it's negative 4 times the Rydberg constant. And so for a helium atom, we can say that the approximate energy, if we ignore electron-electron repulsion, is negative 8 times the Rydberg constant. So we know that the Schrodinger equation can be solved exactly for a hydrogen atom to tell us that its ground state energy is negative Rydberg constant. And if we ignore electron-electron repulsions, we find that the approximate energy of a helium atom is negative 8 times the Rydberg constant. But of course, we made a big approximation here in ignoring electron-electron repulsions. Before going on, I'd like you to think for a few seconds about which direction you think we made this error in. In other words, do you think the true experimental energy of a helium atom is more negative or less negative than negative 8 times the Rydberg constant? The term that we ignore, the electron-electron repulsion, is destabilizing. It's positive. So the true energy of a helium atom turns out to be less negative than the energy that we approximated. It turns out to be about negative 5.8 times the Rydberg constant. This first approximation that we made was pretty rough. There do exist more precise methods, including the variational method and perturbation theory, that allow us to make better approximations of multi-electron atoms. We'll be going through the math of those methods in class. But in the next few slides, I'd like to at least talk qualitatively about what these methods are and how they work. I'll first talk briefly about the variational method. Way back when we introduced the postulates of quantum mechanics, we introduced the idea of an expectation value, the average value of a given property over a large number of measurements. Suppose a system has a ground state energy of E0, corresponding to a normalized ground state wave function that we'll call psi0. If that system is in its ground state wave function psi0, its energy expectation value has to be E0. There's really nothing mysterious about that statement. It's basically saying that if a system is in its energetic ground state, then we will, with 100% probability, measure its energy to be E0. So its energy expectation value, the average of a large number of energy measurements, would also be E0. Variational methods rest on an important idea called the variational principle. This idea is that the energy expectation value of any possible wave function that you could imagine has to be greater than or equal to E0. No matter what wave function we look at, if we calculate its energy expectation value, it can only be greater than or equal to the ground state energy E0. We won't prove this formally, although it's not that difficult. But we can understand qualitatively why this has to be true. Every possible wave function is a superposition of energy eigenfunctions. The ground state eigenfunction, psi0, and also eigenfunctions corresponding to higher energies. So if the system is in an arbitrary wave function, and we measure its energy a large number of times, the result will sometimes be E0, the ground state energy, but it will sometimes be higher energies. The energy expectation value will therefore be some weighted average of E0 and higher energies. And if we take an average of E0 and higher energies, that average can only be higher than E0. The variational principle is summarized by the equation on this slide. The energy expectation value of any arbitrary wave function is greater than or equal to E0. So why is this important? How can we use this fact to approximate the energy of a multi-electron system? The idea is that this gives us a systematic way to look at wave functions to get closer and closer to the ground state wave function and the ground state energy. Basically, we start with some test wave function that has variable parameters. It can be a sum of atomic orbitals, or often it's mathematically easier to make it a sum of Gaussian functions or something like that. And we can vary the coefficients of that test wave function to make our energy as low as possible. We know because of this variational principle that the lower the energy gets, the closer we are to the ground state wave function and the ground state energy. So if we search through a wide range of possible wave functions, calculate their energy expectation values, and make the energy expectation value as small as we can, then we know that we're close to the true ground state wave functions and energies. Variational methods are used very often in computational chemistry, and we'll play around with a numerical example in class. Next, I'd like to talk briefly about perturbation theory, another method to find approximate solutions to multi-electron systems. Perturbation theory assumes that we can split an exact Hamiltonian operator that we can't solve exactly into the sum of one that we can solve exactly and some small correction term, a small perturbation. For example, in the case of a helium atom, we can split up the Hamiltonian into a part that ignores electron-electron repulsion, which we've already seen we can solve exactly, and treat electron-electron repulsion as a correction term. In perturbation theory, we call the part of the Hamiltonian that we can solve exactly H0, and the small correction term H1. We know that the H0 part of the Hamiltonian corresponds to an energy E0 and a wave function Psi0. We also know that if H1 is just a small perturbation, then the wave function Psi0 isn't going to change that much when you add H1. So we can assume that the true wave functions of this system are close to psi naught, which means their energies are close to the energy expectation value of psi naught. The energy expectation value of psi naught is written at the bottom of this slide, and it can be split into one term that we know exactly, E naught, and a second integral, the integral of psi naught star times H1 applied to psi naught. That integral can be calculated, and it's a small perturbation, a small correction to the energy. We'll work through an example in class that treats electron-electron repulsion as a perturbation to the energy of helium. Now that we've talked about some of the math involved in approximating the energies of a multi-electron atom, I'd like to spend the last couple minutes of this video talking about a more qualitative way of looking at things, with the idea of shielding. In a hydrogenic atom or ion, the electron only feels the attraction of the nucleus. But in a multi-electron atom, each electron feels not only the pull of the nucleus, but a partial cancellation of that attraction by the other electrons. You can think of an electron at radius r as feeling what's called an effective nuclear charge, the charge of the nucleus canceled out by all of the electron density inside the radius of that electron. What that means is that electrons in different shapes of orbitals feel different amounts of shielding. Because electrons in s orbitals are most likely to reside near the nucleus, they feel the least shielding and the most positive effective nuclear charge. This gives rise to the ordering of orbital energies that you've probably seen before, where for a given principal quantum number and an atom with more than one electron, the s orbital is lower in energy than the p orbitals, which are lower than the d orbitals, which are lower than the f orbitals. Notice that this energy ordering is in contrast to a hydrogen atom. In a hydrogen atom, or any one electron species, the energy of an orbital depends only on n. So, for example, in a hydrogen atom, 2s and 2p have the same energy. But in a multi-electron atom, 2s and 2p have different energies, and 2s is lower in energy than 2p. This is probably something that you've seen before, and something that's going to become very important as we start building up the periodic table. That's all for now. In the next video, we'll talk about how the quantum mechanics of multi-electron atoms lead to the trends in the periodic table and chemical reactivity that we care about as chemists.